fact brings out a report on global competitiveness. That report classifies the economies into five categories according to their stages of development. It broadly believes that there are three major sources of growth. That maybe you may not fully agree with that, but to a large extent they are right. They believe that the three sources are the basic institutions like some problem. So there are three major sources of growth. The first is the basic requirements like institutions and resources, raw materials, rule of law, property rights, those kinds of things. The second is the efficiency enhancers like competition. And third is the innovation and sophistication. The economies which rely on the first set of factors, namely basic institutions, where reliance on the other two, competition and innovation, is relatively less, say less than 40% of income is generated from these two sources. Such countries typically have a per capita GNP of less than US$2,000. India is in this category. At the other extreme, where the reliance on competition and innovation is high, say 80% of the income emerges from these two sources, these countries typically end up having a per capita GNP of US$17,000. There are several studies to establish this empirically, that the distance between $2,000 to $17,000 is broadly explained by these two factors, competition and innovation. You are familiar with the work of Schumpeter, who says that 50% of productivity growth comes from innovation. And a group of economists led by Baumin, he talks that difference in level of competition accounts for more than 50% of the gap between the gap in GNP of Euro area and the United States. In competition, there will always be somebody ahead of the other. So efficient firms drive out inefficient firms. And in innovation, the new order drives out old order. All of us are interested in growth. All of us want competition and innovation. But that necessarily means that somebody will be falling behind. That necessarily means that something inherent to competition and innovation is failure. So the question is, do we tolerate failure, penalize failure, incentivize failure? How do we handle the failure, or can we avoid failure altogether? Recently, somebody told Mark Zuckerberg actually at Harvard that the greatest success comes from freedom to fail. You know, Thomas Alva Edison, he made 10,000 attempts to perfect a light bulb. He didn't invent it, he just did the perfection, and he told that it's not that I failed 9,999 times. I discovered that things do not work in 9,999 ways. So we have essentially been looking for something how to handle that failure. We can't avoid competition and innovation, but we want to address the failure so that nobody is prohibited, nobody feels uneasy to start a business. If I fail, what to do with that? We started with reforms in the early 90s. In the initial days, our focus was on freedom of entry to do business. That is mostly through reforms in the security laws in the early 90s. The next decade, beginning 2000, our focus was on freedom at the marketplace, freedom to continue business. That mostly we did through reforms in the competition law. And in this decade, we have a new law called Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. freedom of failure. Doubt allows you, that in fact allows the freedom of exit. We had freedom to enter into business, freedom to continue business. Now this way is providing the freedom to exit, the ultimate freedom. It does it in two ways. It believes that the failure is a market outcome and the market itself should handle the failure. It provides a market mechanism whereby somebody, it provides a mechanism which resolves insolvency of a failing entity, and if it is absolutely impossible to resolve insolvency, it provides an orderly mechanism of exit, closure of business, release of resources stuck up there to ultimately use. So what it does essentially is that it reorganizes the business. This law enables reorganization or resolution of business with or without the same management, same set of products, same business line. They may change technology, they may drop a product line, they may also rewrite the rights and obligations of various stakeholders like creditors, equity people, all those things. It allows infinity possibilities of reorganizing the business, including dropping the all the employees, all the workmen, bringing new technologies up to the new set of people. How do they handle that? So that has serious consequences on the people who are already working there and who have a particular skill. And if that does not work out, so there is a provision that how do we allow a very peaceful, least painful, orderly exit. That means close down the business, liquidate the business or the enterprise, release the resources for alternate uses, and it may take 1 year, 3 years, 6 years for the resources to find an alternate use somewhere. So when you liquidate also, then you release the employees. So how do you handle these challenges emanating from resolution and liquidation? Along with this competition and innovation, there is increasing organization of economic activity. Today, sir, I do not produce the shirt I use, or reform the society where I live in, or enjoy the law and order that I do not produce. This law and order, shirt, or society, all these are done collectively with organized effort. Maybe by non-governmental organizations, governments at all levels, central, state, provincial, regional, local governments, or the corporate organizations. Today we have about 1.5 million companies in the country, about 6 million NGOs, and probably if you count the governments at all levels, it exceeds 1,000. So what do all these people do is, they have brought in pull the resources of a larger set of people. Somebody has given money, somebody has given sweat, somebody gives a management. So people have given whatever they could contribute to this organized effort, to a farm, to NGO, to government. And then they sit on the sidelines, look at how the enterprise is performing. A while ago, monopoly was something bad. With the reforms in the competition law, we got a new competition act 2002. Now we no more consider monopoly is bad, abuse of monopoly is. Today the focus of the law is the promotion of competition rather than prohibition of monopoly, and there can be situations where monopoly is also good. So law only intends to prohibit abuse of dominant position. So that means with competition, innovation, increasing organized activity, we are finding more and more benefits from economies of scale, economies of scope. We used to have Adam Smith, the father of economics. He used to argue that if one person tries to produce alpines, he will produce 10 alpines a day. But if 10 people join hands, they will produce 18,000 alpines a day. So that is the kind of benefit we get from organized effort, but along with the organized effort, we distance the stakeholders from the center of action. We have a farm, it has a large number of stakeholders, larger the size of the farm, larger the scale of operations. it is a larger amalgam of a larger number of stakeholders. So if stakeholders are distanced from this place, they do not have a direct say in the affairs of things, but whatever that enterprise does, that affects directly or indirectly interests of these stakeholders. So then we came up with a mechanism that somebody should work for us to keep a watch on how these enterprises are behaving. So we came across something what nowadays fanciful, we call it corporate governance. It was there since times immemorial. Now we have given it a little color and call it. It's now we made it a product. It was a commodity earlier. So we say that let us create a set of people who will ensure compliance with the governance norms. So we came across a professional called company secretary, saying we told them that under the company act section 203, it is the responsibility of a company secretary. We created a new thing with Companies Act called Key Managerial Personnel. So we told that let there be a set of professionals who are responsible to watch the interest of various stakeholders, which is done through corporate governance norms. We needed another set of people to report us that I am located somewhere, I am not holding even the shares directly. With all disintermediated holding, I am existing somewhere in the world. So I wanted that somebody should watch and tell me how this organization is performing. And we came across a professional auditors or chartered accountants who will write the books of account, audit the accounts and tell that yes, we have verified. This is actually what is the outcome of the business. And based on that, the stakeholder decides whether to continue that business or discontinue the relationship. So now we have various examples like this, company secretaries, chartered accountants, and if you look at the new Companies Act 2013, we have all kinds of audits, secretarial audit, cost audit, even in fraud detection. As I told you, we have 1.5 million companies. The state does not take machinery. Does not have wherewithal to exercise direct